chapel, but I'm kind of jumping the gun for the moment, so let me pray and we'll get started. Lord, I love you. I praise you. I pray, Spirit, that you'd be coming into the hearts of these students, even as we just start out this chapel today, that you'd be convicting them just of how they come into chapel and how they want to worship you and know you. I pray, Father, Son, and Spirit, that we could know you, that we'd really want to know you from the depths of who we are. And I know with so many students, having known you and experienced you, God, that we just have that deep sense of reality that that's an amazing miracle and thing. God, that it's not so much that we meet in chapel that's the big deal, it's that you're here. And I praise you for that, and I worship you because of that. And I pray, Lord, that the students would be set free to worship you as well. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so stick with me as we start out here. One of my favorite, my second favorite Narnia book is called A Horse and His Boy. Now, most of you know the Narnia series from The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, but seriously, I'm expecting like three of you to raise your hands. How many of you read A Horse and His Boy? Okay, yeah, there you are, Joshua, I see you. Okay, we got it. It's like a few eighth graders. I kind of get it. Not everyone's read the whole series. I highly recommend it. But it's called A Horse and His Boy for a specific reason. The horse is a prideful horse. Okay, let me explain. The boy and the horse, the boy's name's Shasta and the horse's name's Bree, and they're stuck in the terrible land of Calormen, okay? And they're trying to ride to safety. Now, the horse is a talking horse. If you don't know the Narnia series, you know that all the animals talk. And if you're in Narnia, you're a talking horse. But he's been in Calormen when horses don't talk. And now he's being set free to talk and actually say, like, act like a horse. But here's the problem. He used to be a war horse. And he's all prideful about being a war horse. And he's stuck up. And Shasta, the boy that's on his back, is like, doesn't know how to ride a horse. Got it? So he's like riding a horse for the first time. So he's terrible at it, right? And the horse is always kind of ripping on the boy. And the horse is all prideful. And he's way better than the boy. Got the idea there. And he thinks he's the stuff and all this sort of stuff. And I want to say this right now. The antagonism to this entire message, the bad guy, if you want to put it this way, is our own personal pride. Got it? Just like the horse and a horse and his boy, he has pride. Now, one of my favorite things about the horse and his boy is it has the best Aslan reveals. If you guys know the Narnia series, the God character is a lion. And Bree the horse is like talking about how great he should have been and how great he could have been. And he starts talking about like, oh, Aslan isn't really a lion and all this sort of stuff. But in this world that C.S. Lewis created, he is a lion. And so he's just talking about it. All of a sudden, the lion hops up behind him, sneaks up on him, and then just tickles his back with a whisker. And the horse gets to have his most horse moment in the book and jumps like a mile, falls over, and just is like humbled by running into the lion god. Everyone kind of got the picture there. The god is supposed to humble our pride. I'm not supposed to. It's that encounter with God that's supposed to humble our pride. Okay, now I'm giving you guys all the background of this because as I read to you guys, I'm going to read to you guys an encounter with God in the Bible. And I want to make an argument here. It's in Isaiah. It's Isaiah 6. That's where I'm turning to in the Bible to start out with. It's a relatively famous encounter with God that Isaiah has. I'm assuming some of you have read it before. Some of you may have not. But it's a big encounter with God. Isaiah gets to see God kind of as he really is for the first time. And I'm going to say it this way. And the question I'm asking you guys is this. Have you had this kind of encounter with God? Now, I'm not meaning a vision. I mean, really, God is big and is holy and is powerful and is beautiful and as majestic as he is described in the scriptures. Is that the God that you interacted this morning when you opened up your Bibles and read, even if it was in class or in devotion, or that moment as you're praying on the way to school in car, or as you were, you know, singing along with your worship music, whatever it is that you do to connect with God? It doesn't really matter if it was this morning, was it last night? Was it that God that you engaged? And my answer to it is yes. Yes, it was. But I want to make you aware of how majestic and how holy that God really is. So a couple things just about the thing. I'm going to put up a full of eyes picture. If you guys know my classes at all, I love this guy's website where he like action draws the Bible. There's the picture right there. You can see Isaiah is very small at the bottom. And there's an angel there. I can't even touch the angel issue. I don't have a time. We'll talk about it in class, sophomores, because we're going through spiritual warfare now. But the basic idea is there's these crazy angels crying, holy, holy, holy. So I'm just kind of giving you the orientation. The other thing is, the opening line is, King Uzziah died. Here's the point. It's the longest king in the southern kingdom's history in Judah. And he basically think there's political unrest. So here's Isaiah disoriented by political unrest, and then he sees God. So here you go. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon the throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. And above him stood the seraphim, each had six wings, and with two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And he called out to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the foundations and the thresholds shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people who have unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." And then one of the seraphim flew to me, and having in a hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar, and he touched my mouth and said, "Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away. Your sin is atoned for." Okay, this is a massive picture of God. This is the God of the universe. He's described there with one of the names given to our teams, right? The Lord of hosts, Yahweh, Sabaoth, if I'm saying that right. And he's speaking directly to Isaiah, right? I want you to put that time, I don't know whenever God has spoken to you in whatever manner it may be, but to realize that is the picture of the God who has spoken to you. He is big, he is majestic, and as the angels are describing to him, he is holy, holy, holy. Now, holy as a term means completely separate from us, and we just have to imagine all the way that God is different than us to just do that. Okay, I'm full of sin, he's sinless. I am a creature, he's the creator. I am mortal, he is everlasting and eternal. I am weak, he is strong. I am old and aged, he is majestic and powerful and beautiful. The word glorious is probably too light. And yet, when I got up this morning and I prayed, I'm speaking and I'm talking to that God. And my guess is, actually, I'm confident of it, that you too have engaged that powerful God because, like Isaiah, we are a people, those of you who believed in Jesus, has died on the cross for your sins, that have been atoned for. Now, those of you guys who haven't taken Sophomore Bible yet or haven't quite done, you know that I go through the crosswords. One of them is the atonement. I just talk about how God, through the sacrificial system, through the death of Jesus Christ, has made a way for us to have a relationship with that God. Now, one of the things I like about this Isaiah story is that coal thing. I don't have a whole, like, study on it, but here's the basic idea. Nothing Isaiah does except to recognize that he's sinful, right? I'm unclean lips, right? Allows him to be atoned for. He does nothing. This angel comes down, and I'm just imagining that it like gave him really bad chapped lips or something, but basically comes down and cleanses him by putting the coal on his lips. There's probably some symbolism there that I'm not going for, but I want to rather connect it to what happened for us. We are like that in relationship to God. We walk into his presence and go, "Wow, I'm sinful and you're not." But then we look at the cross of what Jesus Christ, and that's what the picture's doing. It's small at the bottom there. The coal is just a representation of what Jesus has done for us, taken all of our sins by not our own doing, and then called us into the presence of this beautiful, majestic, holy, powerful God. And I want us just to think about that for a moment. Because even as you're hearing, like, I don't know, the Spirit work on your hearts right now, that God is speaking. He's moving. He's working. He's encountering you. And it's in those little moments that you've done in your quiet times and when we come together in our normal in chapel or when you're in your classes teaching that he keeps speaking, moving. This is chapel, guys. I haven't really fully set out what I'm trying to get you guys to do. But I want you guys to worship when we come into chapel in a manner that reflects the truth that we're engaging in worshiping that God. And so I'm gonna ask you guys to do some stuff maybe you're a little bit uncomfortable with when we get into the worship time, but I'm gonna ask you guys to worship God with your bodies that reflects that truth. Everyone kind of got the picture there? That's where it's going with it. Here's why. I think many of you are saved. Many of you have reflected that God. Many of you had deep conversations with me, but we don't always, like, I'll say, reflect it at all the times in our lives. And so I want to challenge you guys, when we come together to hear, I'm trying to, in chapel, I'm trying to celebrate the fact that we're all engaged in that God. If we're going to be doers of the word, we want to engage that God and act like that God who really is truly in our midst is there. I wanted to ask you guys a question, because sometimes we come into chapel and we're like, we're coming in to critique, okay? Oh, Mr. Thomas isn't my favorite speaker. I'd rather have Mr. Ayers, right? And the Bible is actually pretty clear about this. We're not supposed to do that. In fact, Paul in 1 Corinthians addresses this sort of division where you're like, hey, my favorite leader is Paul over there, or it's Peter over here, or Apollos. I'm just putting it in manual terms. You know, Mr. Ayers, your favorite teacher, and you're like, yeah, I want him to speak, but not Mr. Thomas. Mr. Thomas is boring, whatever. Does that make sense? We have this sort of critique towards chapel speakers. Can we all be honest on that, right? We got a sort of idea. I want you guys to address it because the bigger deal is not who's speaking. The bigger deal is the God of the universe. And I love how Paul flips it in 1 Corinthians. He asks this question. Go ahead and put it up there. Do you not know that you are a temple of the Holy Spirit? He almost flips it on his head. He's talking about all this leadership issues and stuff, and then he goes, look, I've got God in me. That's true. I'm Paul. But so do you. So does Riley. So does Carlos. So does Jacob. So does Amaris. So does Jalen, right? Does that make sense? Like, all of you have the same engagement with the same God that I do. And it's like, and then you're worried about who your favorite chapel speaker is? The God of the universe is speaking to us. And we're worried about, I don't know, the song didn't quite sound right, or the speaker hiccuped at the wrong time, or whatever it may be. And so I want to convict us a little bit of that sin so I can free you guys up to worship that God as it really is, because chapel isn't about the speaker. It isn't about the worship, the music. It's about the God in whom we're worshiping. So with this big picture of who God is and how he functions and the reality that he's interacting with us, I have three things that I'm going to challenge all that you that are believers to participate with me in the music right now. Those three things are going to be, one of them we do regularly, one of them a few of us do, and one of them I would argue none of us do. I'm going to challenge all of you to do it as we go into the music and worship. So the response to this chapel will happen in the music time, right? Those three things are to respond by God through singing. Number two, respond to God by lifting your hands. And number three, respond to God by bowing on your knees. Okay, now let me explain. Guys, God created us as physical bodies, right? He's spirit, but we're physical. How I express my body towards God actually matters. What I do in my body, I'm a temple of the Holy Spirit. It actually matters what I do and show. Now, none of these commands, I'm gonna note, are hard. Mr. Wood last time was like, love your enemies. I'm not even asking you to do anything hard right now. I'm asking you to do what I would call the easiest commands in the world. Okay, watch, just everyone lift your hands right now. See, it's not very hard. Okay, I'll explain why that matters in a moment. Bowing on your knees at the end of the day isn't that hard. Got it. We won't have you do that at the moment, but I'll just kind of look at there. But I am showing you guys that it matters because our scriptures describe that this is a normal way to worship God. Okay, so here I need to catch up with my notes here. God created us, his physical bodies. Here, first I want to talk to you guys about singing, okay? All of these commands are going to come from the same book of the Bible. The book of the Bible is Psalms. Psalms is 150 songs that the children of Israel would have sung in their worship to the God of the universe, the same God that we're worshiping here. So just that right there alone gives us, I'll say, the command, if nothing else, to sing. Got it? Now, what are we singing about? There's a lot of things, actually. There's lament psalms, there's praise psalms, there's wisdom psalms. It's sing about basically everything involving God. And sometimes they're difficult, and sometimes they're good. Sometimes they're even vengeful. I mean, I know that sounds strange, but it actually is in there. It's like, go kill your enemies songs. But I'm just going to say it this way. For right now, what I want to focus you guys on, I want you guys to sing, as the Bible lays out for us, songs that praise our God. So number one, respond with God. Respond to God with singing. Okay, here's the song that is the psalm that I wanted to read to you guys. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations and his marvelous works among the peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all the gods. When we come together to worship, let us be singers as the Bible's described. There's a lot I could say here. There's a lot, like Psalms could use its own like chapel series. I'm going to put it that way. But here, I'll just lay it out for you guys. When you're singing about salvation. When you're singing about God. When you're singing about what God has done for us, the works that are going on there. Just think about the words for a moment. Whatever chapel songs come up, they're talking about the God that we are encountering, and we get to worship him and sing back to him. The one I wanted to focus on was bless his name. We hear this type of term. This is not normally words. Sometimes we use the term praise his name. But here's the point. When I articulate with my physical mouth the words of what God has sung, that's sung to God, it blesses him. I'm not exactly sure how, because remember, I'm small, he's big, I'm sinful, he's powerful. But God tells us when we like free ourselves up just to let go and worship him, he's going to be blessed by it. Now, I went to a worship school growing up, okay? I don't know if you know this. It was called the Getz Worship School. It was terrible, I mean, artistically. My grandfather, Joe Getz, is the worst singer I've ever heard. He was deaf, and he was tone deaf. Everyone got it there? He would get into a crowd of 50 people and start singing, right? And nobody else could sing because he was that loud, that obnoxious, and that bad. And it gives me no excuse that I don't sing well, that I don't sound good, because he wasn't worried about what everyone else was doing around him. He had let go of his pride, and he said, all I want to do is praise my God. Everyone got the picture there? Some of the people in here I know you like are like, I'm not as good as the guys up front. I'm not as good as there. I can't sing. That's not my gift. No, we're all commanded to sing, and I would love it if we all sounded terrible together and glorified and blessed the God of the universe. And I want to free you guys up to do that because it's not about how you sound. It is about the God of the universe being worshipped. Everyone kind of got it there? All right. Number two, respond to God with lifting of hands. This psalm, I just want to describe a little background here. It's one of the coolest set of psalms. Psalm of Ascents, Psalm 134. So remember, they had to like travel to Jerusalem. They'd walk together, and they had a set of songs that were set up to walk back and forth to Jerusalem. So you got to imagine you're like on a travel journey here as I read this song. But he's also saying, servants of God, like, come bless God. How are you going to do it? You're going to lift your hands. You'll see. Come bless the Lord, all you servants of the Lord, who stand by night in the house of the Lord. Lift up your hands to the holy place and bless the Lord. Again, I want to point out here, if you do the simple act of lifting your hands, you'll bless the Lord. Now, I know a lot of us come from a lot of different church traditions. And so I want to kind of define it for in here, for at Emmanuel Chapel for a moment. You don't have to do this back at your home church, but I just want you guys to think about this. I want to make it as simple as possible. The Bible says very clearly multiple times, lifting your hands is a sign of worship to God. I want to challenge you guys, those of you guys never lift your hand in worship, just do it. I don't have a particular position. I sent a funny video to Mr. March just for his Friday funnies or whatever, because it was Tim Hawkins talking about, like, you know, all the different hand positions of worship. It doesn't say you have to lift it here or you have to lift it here or you have to lift it here. It just says pick up your hands and say, I'm in worship. It's almost like saying I'm in worship formation right now. Right now, I'm praising and blessing the God of the universe. Everyone got it there? Now, I do think it has some symbolism there. One is God's up in heaven, we're not, and I'm trying to, right, engage and touch and know the living God in the midst of it, right? It also can mean I surrender, like this, right? I surrender. I want the God of the universe to know that I'm going to let him have all the control in the world. Got it? Here's what it doesn't mean. It doesn't mean I feel it more than you. I lift my hands all the time because I don't care, right? I'm telling you this, it's not because I came in here and am less, more awake than you or less tired, you know, more tired than you, less tired than you. I'm more pumped about chapel than you. It has nothing to do with that. It has everything to do with, hey, the Bible tells us to do it, so just simply follow the command, right? That would be the doers of the word part. And then the second part is this, I think my God is worth it. Sometimes when we think of the term, you know, these terms, praise, glory, worship, they, you know, kind of just run together. We all kind of know what it means, but we don't. I like the term worship for this particular chapel the most. Here's why. You can almost hear the word. Worth-ship, right? It's just combined, worship. How much is God worth to you is what we're picturing with our bodies. I know that God, for many of you, is the most important thing in your life. And I want you guys to be able to feel the freedom to reflect that as we come in here. The final one is the most difficult, I think. And it's hard to do, I haven't even say in terms of position, but you want to try it. And here's one of the things I want you guys to do in chapel. I want you guys to get out of your seats and move around, not to like go to the bathroom, but to feel the freedom to worship in the aisles, up front, in locations where you can actually get your bodies into a position of worship. But the final one is respond to God by bowing your knees, okay? I actually think this one's probably repeated more in the Bible. I didn't look up the numbers, but this is my gut, than any of the other two. It says to bow your knees before God more than it does when, you know, it says to lift your hands or to sing, okay? But to respond to God by bowing your knees. Oh, come let us worship, this is Psalm 95. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. When we kneel before God, we rightly order ourselves in relationship to the God of the universe. We say with our bodies, he's big, I'm small. He's the king, I'm the servant. He's the leader, I'm the one to be led. We rightly order ourselves. We act out with our bodies that we are made in the image of God and reflect the appropriate order we are in response to him. Has everyone kind of got the picture there? And notice there in that psalm, come let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our maker. Like, it literally is in the middle of group worship. That wasn't like privately in your homes. That's good to bow before God privately in your homes. Don't get me wrong. It's come together and let's show it with our bodies. Now, I'm going to ask you guys right now, as we come into worship, to stretch yourselves, to use your bodies in the nature of worship. But I need to get back to the point. Don't just do it mechanically. Right? Like, okay, Mr. Thomas said so go do it. Pause and think about these two truths. Number one, the God in Isaiah 6 that was described to you guys, that's been described to you guys all throughout this year, throughout your Bible classes, is the one that is here with us in chapel. Number two, you guys that know Jesus are the temple of the Holy Spirit. You're the ones that get to reflect that God to the universe. And whenever you come into chapel, that ultimately is the goal. I'm gonna call the worship team up. They're gonna come up and worship. I'm gonna pray. I'm gonna do a 1 Timothy 2:8 kind of prayer just in light of what I was talking about. 1 Timothy 2:8 talks about men lifting their hands in prayer. Got it? So everyone, take your hands, go like this. Lift them up in front of God. All right, I'm gonna pray. And then I'm going to get out of the way, and I'm going to let us freely and with the commands that are given to us to worship God with all of our hearts, our souls, our minds, our strengths, and our body. God, I love you. Address our sin of pride that doesn't allow us to worship you as freely as we ought. I pray, Lord, that we'd forget ourselves for a moment and get lost just in the majesty and the beauty and the power that you are. Thank you, Jesus, for laying down your life for us. Thank you that you sacrificed for us and have atoned completely for us. And there's not one thing, not my tiredness, not my frustrations, not whatever it is, that keeps us from your presence. Because we know God, we know Jesus, we know Spirit, that you've made a way for us. God, I pray that we'd reflect that right now as we worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand and worship with us.
Quiet. You can have it all. Here I am. Jesus Christ. Father, I thank you for this day, Lord. I thank you for Mr. Thomas being able to speak to us. I pray just for the rest of this week, Lord, that we can learn more about you. I pray for this day. I pray that if anyone's struggling with anything, that you would just help them, Lord, and that we would all leave from this place safe. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.